Macmillan Audio presents I Spy by Daniel Ribacoff. Read for you by Fred Berman.
Introduction. Everybody wants to know the truth. Your next-door neighbor says your kid hit a baseball through his front window, but your son says the guy's nuts. Who's telling the truth? Your husband has been coming home late for the past 2 weeks and complains that he's been slammed with work. Do you believe him, or do you suspect that he's cheating on you? A young man applies for a job at your firm, and you don't know him from Adam, but his resume's stellar, and he looks like a good kid. Should you hire him? Has he been fired from other jobs? Is he setting you up for harassment or for a hostile work environment lawsuit? How can you find out? Private Investigation is about digging through layers of lies and deception and coming out on the other side with that kernel of truth, the fact behind the fiction, and the evidence to prove it. It's about finding and filtering information, getting what's coming to you, and protecting what's important to you. It's about getting to the bottom of a situation using your noodle and your know-how. And with a little training and practice, you can do it like a pro. Who am I? For many years, my family owned a Midtown Manhattan diamond company and jewelry manufacturer, founded in 1979 by my father, a retired engineer. You want to know about theft and security and having eyes in the back of your head? Try being a diamond dealer. One day, my father went into the office early in the morning in order to meet a courier from a jewelry store in a neighboring county. The doorbell rang, and my father answered the door to see that the courier had brought another man with him. Both were armed with guns, a lead pipe, and an ice pick. When security arrived within minutes, my father was unconscious on the floor. Portions of his scalp were hanging off from having been beaten with a lead pipe, and his shirt was bloody from being stabbed with the ice pick. My father survived the attack, but is legally blind to this day. The courier's accomplice was caught and served 25 years in prison. The courier, however, managed to escape, and they never found him. Around this time, I joined the New York City Auxiliary Police, a team of volunteers who assist their local police precincts, housing police service areas, and transit districts. I served as a sergeant in the citywide special task force and received numerous awards of merit and commendations, including one from the National Police Hall of Fame. We performed uniformed patrol and were recruited, trained, and equipped by the New York Police Department, NYPD. I served in the NYPD until 1994 and have been serving the Nassau County Police Department as an auxiliary cop since 2006. We did street patrol in every precinct in the city and worked special events, jet games, parades, you name it. We were there for Mayor Koch's first inauguration. I learned everything there was to know about New York City as an auxiliary cop, the people, the streets. Neighborhoods that you never even would have thought of going to, we went to. And there was no GPS back then. In those days, if you didn't know where you were going, you didn't know where you were going, so you really learned your way in and around the city fast. In 1990, I started the International Investigative Group. I came up with the idea of offering consulting investigative work for people like my father and others who worked jobs in industries that dealt in valuables and for which security was of utmost importance. I began working with Lloyd's of London, Tiffany & Company's insurance company, and other firms that insured jewelers, jewelry stores, traveling jewelry salesmen, and jewelry manufacturers. For 2 years, I was a diamond dealer by day and a private eye by night. I put a phone on the wall and answered it every time it rang. At the time, I had 2 kids and my wife was pregnant with our third, until I could get the private investigation business up and running. I would come home at night, type reports, do research. Remember, there was no internet back then. Until 4 o'clock in the morning. Get up a few hours later and go back to work in the jewelry business. Slowly, through word of mouth, the business grew. My first private investigative job was for Harry Winston. I investigated a courier who claimed that he was robbed of $750,000. I branched out from there. Armored truck losses, million-dollar burglaries, workers' comp investigations, auto accidents, domestic suits. I put up my sail and went wherever the wind took me, building my investigative business one brick at a time. Within a few years, I began studying with an established polygraph examiner, a real old-timer with 40 years' experience under his belt. He was a little guy with a Hitler mustache and a bad toupee and a deep voice. When you spoke to him on the phone, you'd think that he was 6'9". He started throwing me some investigative work so he could focus on polygraphing, more commonly known as lie detecting. He became my mentor, and years later, after he passed away, I incorporated polygraph services into my own business. I also studied formally under one of polygraph and forensic interviewing's foremost researchers, Nathan J. Gordon, the director of the Academy for Scientific Investigative Training in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, as well as William L. Fleischer, who serves as the assistant director of the Academy and is a former FBI and U.S. Customs polygraph expert. The Steve Wilkos Show. The business grew steadily over the years, and I started getting calls to do TV. I did technical consulting for the Guiding Light soap opera, where I set up a polygraph scene for an actor playing a detective, and I appeared on the National Geographic Channel, as well as programs such as The Tyra Banks Show, The Millionaire Matchmaker, Impractical Jokers, and The Today Show, among many others. In early 2009, I got a call from The Steve Wilkos Show, a syndicated daytime talk show hosted by Steve Wilkos, who once served as the director of security for the Jerry Springer Show. The producers were looking to hire a polygraph examiner in the New York tri-state area. At the time, NBC was moving production for shows such as Jerry Springer, The Steve Wilkos Show, Maury, and Deal or No Deal from Chicago to Connecticut. I was like, Deal or No Deal? I get to see the models? I love Model 21. I went for the interview, they liked me, and I began working for them that year. A former Chicago cop, Steve Wilkos is a great guy and a great interviewer. We sort of make a Lone Ranger and Tonto type of team. Since I've been there, the show has focused more on criminal investigation rather than relationship topics. We cover everything from murder to molestation. I'm their polygraph guy. They turn to me to help weed out the liars. Guy comes on the show, says he's never cheated on his girlfriend, and then after conducting a thorough polygraph exam, I deliver the report to Steve that says whether the guy's telling the truth or is full of crap. Most times, even before I conduct a formal polygraph test, I can tell if someone's lying. The signs of deception are there, and I'm always surprised that more people can't recognize them. It's a good skill to have. Virtually everyone has something to gain from learning the fundamentals of lie detection and other basic investigative skills. They're applicable to business owners, parents, spouses, school administrators, and more. Want to keep tabs on your kids? Your employees? Want to track down that old flame of yours from high school? Want to know if your wife is running around on you? Want to pull a home alone on a would-be burglar? You can. During my years as an investigator, many people have contacted me with requests for very simple jobs that they can do themselves. They just don't realize it. And a lot of investigation is common sense. And nowadays, there's so much information available online that makes detective work, particularly background checks or locating assets or people, so much easier. Most of the research I conduct is through public records. The key is knowing where to find information, how to access it, and how to interpret it. Would you make a good private investigator? Basic investigation is pretty easy, But it's important to note that nearly all 50 states require private investigators to be licensed, and many government municipalities are cracking down on unlicensed operations. This means that you, as a civilian, cannot open a business as an unlicensed private eye, nor can you conduct investigations for hire. Purpose of this book is to help you perform your own private investigations for personal matters, with strategies used by the pros in order to keep you and your loved ones safe. That said, virtually anybody with lots of practice can learn to do this type of work, but there are certain qualities that a successful investigator will likely have. Number one, are you willing to work around the clock? There are no set hours when it comes to private investigation. It's not Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. Many times you're working during holidays, weekends, snowstorms, whatever it might be. Sometimes you'll be on a surveillance job and sit on a guy for 16, 17, 18 hours straight. You've got to be willing to put in the time. Number two, are you willing to do your homework? For licensed professionals, private investigation is a para-law enforcement type of position. You often have to testify in court, so you have to be sure you're familiar with the legal do's and don'ts. Amateur sleuths also need to be familiar with lawful matters, such as citizens' rights and privacy laws. You don't want to do anything illegal or get sued civilly. Number three, do you have a good poker face? Sometimes you have to lie to find the truth. Police officers and private investigators do it all the time. Once I was conducting a surveillance, and a guy comes up and knocks on my car window. "What are you doing here?" he asked. "I'm an auto repossessor," I said without hesitation. "Whose car are you here to repossess?" "I can't tell you that, because then the guy's not going to give me the car." "You're not here to repossess my car, are you? Do you have a Mercedes?" "No." "Then you're okay, bro." And he left me alone. As long as you look and act credible, and you're polite, respectful, and not breaking the law, you are likely to be believed. Number four, can you act? Sometimes lying isn't enough. If you're trying to gather information by subterfuge, you've got to be able to play different roles. Today, I'm a news reporter working on a big story. Tomorrow, I'm your old high school classmate looking to organize a 30-year reunion. Or I'm doing a background check for an employer. Or I'm your long-lost Uncle Pete. Trust me, when it comes to acting, Meryl Streep's got nothing on me. Can you convince somebody that you're someone else? As a private eye, you may have to. Number five, are you willing to travel out of your neighborhood? A friend of mine is a veterinarian. He owns a chain of clinics. And at this point in his career, he does the management, so he's bored. He comes to me and says, "I'd love to be a private investigator. It seems so exciting. Would you hire me?" I said, "Yeah, I need you to interview a couple of people in the Marcy Houses project in Brooklyn." He goes, "Are you kidding? I'm not going to the housing project." Guess what? Then you can't be an investigator. Everybody thinks it's glamorous all the time. Trust me, it's not. We often rate neighborhoods by how many guns we need to carry to work there. A one-gun, two-gun, or three-gun neighborhood. We go to some really bad places. If you're a private investigator, you can't say, "I'm going to work here, but I'm not going to work there." You've got to go where the job takes you. Number six, are you willing to travel outside of your comfort zone? Remember the Motorola beepers? Everybody had a beeper in the 90s. I used to have a beeper that had a little pinhole camera with a wire that you could attach to a video recorder. My guys would put it in a knapsack and walk the streets of Manhattan like messengers, and they'd have beepers in their pocket and could film people in public areas. One time, an insurance company executive said to me, "This girl was in a car accident. She says she can't work. We think she's working. I need proof." She was an exotic dancer in New Jersey. We followed her, and she went to this place called Heartbreakers, a strip club. I put one of my best agents on the case, a Puerto Rican guy named Carlos. You can put a Latino guy anywhere, in the city, the suburbs, on a farm, and he'll fit in. I said, Carlos, you have to get footage of this girl working, dancing. Be careful, because they search you when you go into these clubs and you can't get caught with a camera. So Carlos goes into his car, breaks down the camera equipment, and sticks it in his crotch, knowing that they won't search him there. And when he gets inside the place, he goes in the bathroom and puts the camera back together. He then sticks the unit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.